Well, good morning. Hi, well, it's so good to see you guys on this third Sunday in Advent. We've got a lot going on today. Excuse me. But in the third Sunday in Advent is also called the Gaudete or Rejoice Sunday. And it's the day that we light the pink candle, the Rejoice candle. And it's Rejoice Sunday for a number of reasons. It's on in some liturgical seasons. This is a Sunday where the angel Gabriel appears to Mary and kind of lets her know that she's going to be the Christotokos. And we also have on some Sunday, some liturgical years, the reading from Philippians chapter 4, which says, rejoice always. Again, I say rejoice. But this third Sunday in Advent, this Gaudete Sunday, is a little different. We have kind of a juxtaposition of sorts where we are talking about rejoice, but yet we have a very disappointed question that John the Baptist asked Jesus in our gospel lesson. And I think that speaks to some feelings that people may be having this kind of year, this time of year. But also today, we're also celebrating Sankta Lucia, which you'll find out, hear more about during our service, but it's just going to be nothing but adorable and cute and wonderful. It's a great tradition. And also, we are welcoming new members to our Augustana family. We will be welcoming Daniel and Barbara Stoles and their two sons, Jonathan and Nick. And they're sort of like it's a coming home for them of sorts. As I've heard people say that the last time they saw Jonathan, he was really, really small. And you will see he is not really small anymore. We'll also be welcoming Sarah Arndt, who began worshiping with us this summer and is now a full-fledged member of our choir. And Mike Gertz, who many of you might have already thought he was a member, but he is not until today. So that is exciting. And also Franklin and Jenny Morales, who began worshiping with us a few months ago when they arrived here from Venezuela and have immediately made their gracious presence known to some people here in Augustana, but especially with the Santa Maria community. They're going to be joining our congregation as well. Other announcements. It's still not too late to turn in your pledge sheet for the stewardship drive. Please hand that into the office or put that in the offering plate. We will get it. That's great. Please also check your bulletin for the rest of the Advent and Christmas schedule. And keep in mind that this year, Christmas is actually on Sunday. So in fact, 2 weeks from today is Christmas. Is everybody ready? No. All right, we got 2 weeks. And also, don't forget, if you're going to be ordering poinsettias, please do so as well. The money for that and the order sheet should go in the offering plate. And just know that you are a visitor with us, that you are welcome to your communion table. If you could fill out the attendance sheets in your pews, and if you're a first-time visitor, there should be a welcome card in a pew back near you. You could fill that in, let us know more about you. We would appreciate that. And I know there's still time to do gifts of hope during the fellowship hour. Any other announcements? All right, well, let us prepare our hearts for worship.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Today we pause at the baptismal font to receive and support sisters and brothers who have expressed their desire to be received into the membership of Augustana by affirmation of baptism. We'll come and gather around the font. Friends, as you are received into membership into this church, do you intend to continue in the covenant God made with you in holy baptism? To live among God's faithful people, to hear the word of God and share in the Lord's Supper, to proclaim the good news of God in Christ through word and deed, to serve all people following the example of Jesus, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth? If so, respond individually. I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
People of God, do you promise to welcome and embrace these sisters and brothers and to pray for them in their life in Christ?
We do,
and we ask God to help and guide us. Let us pray. Gracious God, thank you for the newness of life in holy baptism. We pray for these sisters and brothers as they become members of Augustana, to share in the mission and work you give us. Strengthen them with your gifts of grace. Instill in them the spirits of wisdom and understanding and of the knowledge and fear of the Lord. Again and again, refresh them with the joy of your presence through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Loving God, in the waters of baptism you make your children, but we drift away from your holy desires for us. Even as we affirm our baptism, we turn to you again and again to offer our confession. Gracious God,
have mercy on us. We confess that we turn from you and allow ourselves to grow distant from you. Acknowledging this, we humbly repent and ask that you embrace us in your compassion. Forgive us our sins, known and unknown, what we have done and what we have failed to do. Turn us again to you. Breathe your holy breath into us. Grant that we, in newness of life, may love and serve you in the ways of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Sisters and brothers, I declare to you that Almighty God forgives you all your sins. God empowers you who believe to wholeheartedly embrace your lives for a new beginning and a new day. By the breath of the Holy Spirit, the Creator God claims you through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Now let us welcome our new members. Please take the time to greet them and meet them individually during coffee hour. Thank you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord, stir up your people and come. Your light is coming into the world. Lucia, a name that means light, shone your light that gives sight. Like Lucia, may we see you more clearly and follow you more nearly, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Morning. Good morning. Midwinter night, the cold is hard, the stars glimmer and shine. All asleep on a lonely farm, deep in the hour of midnight. The moon travels its silent path, the snow shines white upon the pines. The snow shines white upon our roofs. Only the Christmas tomte wakes from the woods. Quiet lie the woods and the whole country round. All life is slumbering. From afar the stream sounds, a hushed rushing. The tomte listens and half dreaming, thinks that he hears time streaming. Wonders whither it shall go. Wonders where the fountain may flow. More than 100 years ago, the Swedish writer Victor Rydberg wrote this poem about a tomte in midwinter. His poem is still famous in Sweden today. A tomte is something like an elf from Scandinavian folklore. The tomte, or nisse, takes care of a farmer's home and children. He protects them from misfortune, especially at night when they are asleep. A tomte is short and wears a red cap. Perhaps we will see some today.
Thank you. December 13th is the day that Swedes and others all over the world honor the legend of Saint Lucia. For many, many years, Lucia has brought faith, hope, and a reason to believe in good things to come. Her legend comes to us from Syracuse on the island of Sicily. It is thought that during the time when the rulers of the land did not look favorably upon Christianity, a woman named Lucia had devoted her life to God and to the poor. She gave her entire dowry to the poor, and the man she was to marry was very upset by this. Lucia was put on trial, where she refused to renounce her Christian beliefs and was put to death. There are many theories on how the legend of Lucia came to Sweden. It could have been brought by priests, German traders, or even by the Vikings and their adventures to southern Europe. No one knows just how it evolved into the Swedish tradition it is today, and there are many versions of a Swedish Sankta Lucia story. Whatever the facts to the legends surrounding Lucia, the truth is that her courage to stand up and be counted a Christian in spite of torture and death is the light that may lead us on our own journey through life.
A reading from the Gospel according to Luke. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it in a cellar, but on the lampstand, so that those who enter may see the light. Your eye is the lamp of your body. If your eye is healthy, your whole body is full of light. But if it is not healthy, your body is full of darkness. Therefore, consider whether the light in you is not darkness. If then your whole body is full of light, with no part of it in darkness, it will be as full of light as when a lamp gives you light with its rays. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. It's a tough act to follow. The second reading is from the fifth chapter of the book of James. Be patient, therefore, beloved, until the coming of the Lord. The farmer waits for the precious crop from the earth, being patient with it until it receives the early and the late rains. You also must be patient. Strengthen your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is near. Beloved, do not grumble against one another, so that you may not be judged. See, the judge is standing at the doors. As an example of suffering and patience, beloved, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 11th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When John heard in prison what the Messiah was doing, he sent word by his disciples and said to him, "Are you the one who is to come, or are we to wait for another?" Jesus answered them, "Go and tell John what you hear and see. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the poor have good news brought to them. And blessed is anyone who takes no offense at me." As they went away, Jesus began to speak to the crowds about John. "What did you go out into the wilderness to look at? A reed shaken by the wind? What then did you go out to see? Someone dressed in soft robes? Look, those who wear soft robes are in royal palaces. What then did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I tell you, and more than a prophet. This is the one about whom it is written, 'See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way before you.' Truly, I tell you, among those born of women, no one has arisen greater than John the Baptist. Yet, the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
O come, Emmanuel.
O come,
I
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I do want to welcome an important person in the life of the congregation, which I forgot to mention at the beginning, and I apologize that I did not. But among us this day is Pastor Kathy Rosenholz and her husband as they are house hunting. They are all eagerly excited and awaiting your arrival in February. So welcome. Well, grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
An Army Airborne Ranger was learning to parachute. So after the plane took off, the sergeant gave last-minute orders. Number one, jump when you're told to jump. Number two, count to 10 and then pull the ripcord. Number three, if the first chute doesn't open, pull the second ripcord. Number four, when you land, a truck will take you back to the post. And he repeated those again. And so when the plane got over the jump zone, everybody stood up and there was a soldier in line and he jumped out. And as he jumps out, he's like, all right, count to 10. One, two, counted to 10. He pulled the ripcord. Nothing happened. It's like, okay, number, pull a second. So he pulls the second ripcord. Nothing happens. And he's like, oh, great. I bet the truck's not even going to be there to pick me up. One our gospel lesson today. John may not be physically plummeting, but I think his hopes and dreams sure seem to be, because he finds himself in jail. His cell is dark and dank, as prison cells tend to be, and he's pacing back and forth, feeling worried and disappointed. Sure, he's worried about being in jail and his uncertain future, and if you skip ahead in the gospel, doesn't look good for him. But more than that, he's disappointed by what he's been hearing about Jesus. See, John has spent his entire adult life preparing the way for the Messiah. And just last week, we got a glimpse of what that looked like and how he prepared. He was convinced that the Messiah would come and clean house. He would pick up the axe at the root of the trees and start cutting down all those who were not producing good fruit. He would use the winnowing fork and divide the wheat from the chaff and the righteous from the unrighteous, putting the wheat in the granary and burning the chaff with unquenchable fire. To say the least, when the Messiah came, John was convinced that heads were going to roll. And people, especially the religious and political leaders, better watch out. He spent his entire adult life speaking this message. But now sitting in prison some months later, after baptizing Jesus, whom he was convinced was the Messiah, John is growing rather disappointed and depressed. Because he doesn't see heads rolling and wrath being dished out. The world has not changed one bit. And John's an example that the rich and the powerful still continue to get away, soon to be, literally with murder. Had he been wrong about Jesus? Was Jesus the Messiah? So growing more depressed that life continues to be one darn thing after another and no change in sight, he begins to get disappointed in Jesus. So John sends his disciples to ask him quite plainly and frankly, are you the one who is to come? Or should we be looking for somebody else? And I have to admit, this seems very odd to have this reading and this conversation on the third Sunday in Advent, exactly 2 weeks before Christmas. I mean, this time of year, even the early curmudgeons like myself begin to get into the Christmas spirit. And especially on this Gaudete Rejoice Sunday. And so having this story about someone's disappointment in the Son of God just seems odd today. But as odd as it might be, I think this reading is very helpful for this time of year. Because, well, aren't we still waiting for the fulfillment of the Christmas promise? For peace on earth and goodwill among all people? Aren't we tired of things looking all too much the same? Doesn't it become hard to have good cheer as the headlines and sometimes even our lives regularly make it clear that peace and goodwill are as scarce today as they were 3 months or even a millennia ago? Since things don't seem to be changing or improving too dramatically, might John be verbalizing a question that some of us might feel sometimes? Especially this time of year, might there be some people who are disappointed that God has not acted, or disappointed in the way the world works? Instead of rejoicing, might some simply be repeating, Kyrie eleison, Lord, have mercy. I mean, this time of year has long been associated with increased depression and fear. Counseling requests increase. Conversations with the pastor increase this time of year. Admissions into care and rehab facilities rise, and even suicide attempts tend to peak this time of year. As we are approaching the longest night of the year, I think we need to recognize that there are still people who dwell in deep darkness, even on this Rejoice Sunday. So sure, I mean, we try to put on a smile in public, but I will guarantee you that there are people in your lives, people in your family, people in this congregation that feel very much like John. Disappointed. Disappointed with themselves, disappointed with the world, disappointed with their life, and even possibly disappointed with God. I think because of this, some churches offer what's called kind of a blue Christmas service in order to provide space for people to grieve and have those disappointments, to name them, to offer them up to God. And why next week, because I don't think we could fit it all in this week, we will have a rite of healing. And why I think Jesus' response to John is telling. He says, go and tell John what you hear and see. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the poor have good news brought to them. You see, while John wanted drastic comeuppance to occur and radical world change, Jesus brings grace and healing and a ministry of presence. And while it may not be the Jesus John wanted, I think it's the Jesus that many people need. Yes, someone who doesn't live up to our expectations, who doesn't make heads roll or shake up the powers that be, but instead dwells with us, willingly enters into the dark places of our lives and walks with us. Maybe that's why whoever set up these readings had this juxtaposition of our gospel lesson on this Rejoice Sunday. Maybe this season we need to be reminded that in Matthew's gospel, Jesus truly is Emmanuel, God with us. That in our darkness, God enters in. That we can rejoice even in times and days of darkness because we have a God who knows our pain and disappointment and stays with us, draws closer to us in those times. So maybe that's why we also celebrate Santa Lucia today, who entered in some legends, who entered into the dark catacombs, scattering the darkness with her candles as she nourished, walked alongside, and brought hope to those in dark times. And maybe this ministry of presence, this God with us, reminds us that even in these days that are more dark than light, we too can be present and walk with others. That we, with our presence, can allow the light of Christ to shine through us and scatter someone's darkness, even if it is for a moment, in order to give them hope for another day. And so while this gospel lesson with John's concerns and disappointments and questions seems odd this time of year, I truly feel it is a message that those who feel they are plummeting in despair and disappointment desperately need to hear today. Amen.
Suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again. In the glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
As we anticipate the fullness of the presence of Christ, we join with the church throughout the world, praying for all who are in need. For the church and all messengers of the gospel, especially our bishops Elizabeth and Richard, our pastor Tom, and our pastor-elect Kathy, and for all who call upon the name of the Lord, including our sisters and brothers in the Salvadoran Lutheran Church, the Church of Sweden, and the suffering Coptic Orthodox Church of Alexandria, that God would work in and through us to bring harmony and reconciliation. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
For forests and deserts, for wilderness and developed land, and for plants blossoming and dormant, that the splendor and diversity of creation would proclaim your glory. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
For our government, for the military and international relief workers, and for all those who care for the stranger, widow, and orphan, that God would raise up leaders who will work for the protection of all. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
For the hungry, homeless, incarcerated, for the fearful and sorrowful, for those living with acute and chronic disease, mental illness or addiction, and those who dwell in deep darkness with doubt, disappointment, and depression. Especially for our members and friends, Paul, Margaret, Deborah, Betty, Bob, Mary, Thomas, Randall, Novella, Edith, Warren, Alex, Olivia, Carol, Pearl, Herman, Diane, Laura, Heidi, David, Ruth, Renee, Eric, Austin, Ingrid, Graciela, Anna, Herman, Diane, Mary, Craig, Norma, Joy, Nicole, Shadana, Al, Deborah, Mike, Tracy, Carol, Robert, the Lyons family, Shazad, the McBee family, Tom, Gordon, Noah, and Jonathan. May each one know the loving presence of Emmanuel, God with us. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
For all who call this community home, for those visiting from near and far, and for those preparing for the holiday season, that the advent of Christ would make our hearts and minds rejoice. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
In thanksgiving for all the departed who were faithful to God's word, especially John the Baptist and Lucia of Syracuse, that their words and actions direct us to the one who prepares a way for us. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, trusting in your presence in, with, and through all times and all circumstances, through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
come to us again. May the fruits of light we see in the field shine on those who dwell in darkness. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You comforted your people with the promise of the Redeemer, through whom you will also make all things new in the day when he comes to judge the world in righteousness. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy,
the beginning and the end, the giver of life. Blessed are you for the birth of creation. Blessed are you in the darkness and in the light. Blessed are you for your promise to your people. Blessed are you in the prophet's hopes and dreams. Blessed are you for Mary's openness to your will. Blessed are you for your son Jesus, the Word made flesh. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. With this bread and cup, we remember your word dwelling among us, full of grace and truth. We remember our new birth in his death and resurrection. We look with hope for his coming. Holy God, we long for your spirit. Come among us. Bless this meal. May your word take flesh in us. Awaken your people. Fill us with your light. Bring the gift of peace on earth. All praise and glory are yours, Holy One of Israel, Word of God incarnate, Power of the Most High, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in grace.
Amen.
Let us pray. Dear God,
with the bits of bread and sips of wine, you keep your promise to us. You come to us through this meal and embrace us with your presence. Without fear, we now look ahead to days that are uncertain. To those who dread the coming days, send us to be their companions. Through Jesus Christ, our
Lord.
Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.